yeah, without further ado, I'll hand you over to Jason and the microphone.
Should I introduce myself?
You can.
Oh, I'm just wondering, is there anyone here who doesn't know who I am?
Who is that guy? Get off the stage! Yeah, basically. I'm Nicole's husband. You pretty much all know who Nicole is. Okay, very quickly, for the benefit of the millions of hits that you'll get on YouTube, my name is Jason Stark. I've worked in the games industry for, I don't know, a couple of decades. Well, so long. I am no longer. So after a while of working in the games industry, AAA, mostly in Chrome Studios, the games industry went kablooey in Brisbane, so we went to the beach, and while we're at the beach, we decided to form our own game studio, consisting of me, my wife, and my second daughter, Raven, who has since escaped.
Well, that would be great if someone took that control system and actually made a fun game with it. That was 4 years ago. And so we quickly put together a prototype for Ninja Pizza Girl. There was a lot of really interesting, touching family stuff in between that moment and getting the prototype there, which I've written a few Polygon articles about. So it's Polygon and me. It's, you'll cry and stuff. It's fine. It's mostly made up. I don't really love my children. Anyway, so we took two iPads and a booth to the very first PAX Oz. The booth we flew in an airplane as luggage. That was the first bad decision. That was a lot of fun. It's okay, I made my children carry most of it. And we set up, and we had two iPads running Ninja Pizza Girl because it was an iPad game. It could also be played on a phone. We had my phone as well. That was our backup demo device. We had two iPads. We had a phone. It was great. Good iOS title. Not a lot of people were interested in us. We were set up next to the toilets and across from a glass case which did not contain an Xbox One. And the very first morning, all this press kept walking past us to take photos of the empty glass case, which was a low point for us. But things did steadily pick up as the show went on. And this is where the first bad decision occurred, because we got no iOS press during that entire meeting. We got quite a few people playing the game and really liking it. But what we did get was we got Megan from PC Power Play, which was a real magazine. And this was 4 years ago, so magazines actually mattered. Back when, yeah, press still existed and didn't just consist of 13-year-olds with YouTube accounts. So we were... And excellent community radio, of course. Hey. The backbone of modern media. And Megan said, this game's really awesome. I'll finish this piece with one sentence, and then you can be in there. And she asked us, this game's good, is there a PC version? And we said, yeah. Yes, there is. And she said, can you give it to me after the show? And I said, we sure can. Now, what was your question? Point, addition. You waved the flag, what do you...
I'm super interested in know what you said, that Unity 5 is a land of lies.
A land of lies, yeah, that's kind of, you have to ask a question pertinent to what I'm saying.
It's just puzzling me, so I want to know.
You want to know why Unity 5 is a land of lies? Oh, you have to ask something pertinent to what I'm saying now, and if you can interrupt me with an interesting, thoughtful point, then you get to hold the flag, and then you can choose Unity 5 as a land of lies afterwards. So if you've got anything you want to ask related to my current story, okay, well, keep listening.
It's around the same story.
we'll get there. Okay. We'll get there. And it kind of snowballed from there. So I quickly went home and I made a PC version. And then we went to the GCAP afterwards, and there were representatives from Nintendo there looking for indie devs for the Wii U. And like many years ago, I can't even calculate it, 25 years ago, I played Super Mario Brothers on the NES. And that was a very magical moment for me. And the idea of our game being on an NES or on a Nintendo console, an NES would be difficult, overrode all reason. And so we chased that as hard as we could with absolutely no thought of business or productivity ramifications. We just went, yes, we'll go for this. And I remember the day that we got approved for Nintendo development, I literally ran around my house with my arms in the air going whoop, whoop, whoop. I don't know what the neighbors thought. I didn't care. I was a very happy man. And it continued to snowball. The Kickstarter, we ran a Kickstarter. That didn't help things, because when you're running a Kickstarter, you're absolutely desperate for anything to look important, to look different, to look more real, genuine. Please, oh God, give us money. We're running a Kickstarter. And so we chased the Xbox. We managed to get the Xbox at the during the course of that Kickstarter. And that was solely because my wife went, it's okay. What's happening?
There was writing all over your face, so I thought it was a bit distracting, so I'm trying to turn it off. There we go.
Damn. I was enjoying that blinding blue light in my eyes. She chased Microsoft literally all around the world. She just kept going to international events and hounding Microsoft representatives, showing them the game. They go, yeah, that game's really great, it's cool, yeah, you guys are wonderful, please stop bothering me. And he said, oh, look, we can't let you develop for the Xbox. We only are letting people with previous console experience. And then Nicole goes, well, my husband has previous console experience, which is almost true. because I'd done art that had ended up on a console somehow through magic or fairies or something. And so we just kept chasing them. Sony sort of came to us. We tried applying for Sony because Sony were all wonderful and nice to these guys anyway. Yeah. And they kept telling the world how nice they were. Is Sony going to watch this?
Maybe.
Okay,
hopefully.
That's good.
I'll add some tags.
They were horrible. They were horrible. Just absolutely horrible. You'd apply for their system. And they go, yeah, cool. Yeah, excited to have you on board. We'll get right back to you. Months would pass. Nothing would happen. You'd send email would just slip into the void. Eventually you would personally tweet out Sir Shahid, is that how you pronounce his name? Shahid, he used to work for Sony. He was like the one guy who did any work at Sony, and he was superhuman. Like, it didn't matter what time zone you were in, you could tweet, and within seconds you'd get a personalized response. And he would go yell at people, and you'd progress.
And he's not at Sony anymore.
I know. He's since left. And then it would stop again. And then you'd tweet a cheat and he'd yell at people and it would progress. And eventually I'd go, look, screw you. We've got Nintendo and Xbox. There's probably more than we should be taking on. So, fine. And then at PAX Oz, the third PAX Oz, this nice man goes up to Nicole and looks up at our poster and says, oh, why is Sony not there? And she goes, oh, you know, and she says, nice. Public friendly responses, like, you know, it's just not a good fit, or, you know, we're flat out, we're busy with stuff. And he kept pushing and just being really persistently inquisitive, and eventually she started telling the truth. And just going, you know, screw those guys, they're horrible. And, you know, we just got jerked around and we hate them, so fine, they're not getting our game. And then he says, hi, I work for Sony. And he was really nice. That was Spencer, by the way. If anyone knows Spencer, no, good. Anyway, Spencer's lovely. So Spencer can see that bit. That's Spencer. And he fixed up something. He convinced us to take on Sony too. So we ended up with these three consoles on a budget that wasn't really enough to finish the PC version. it really is a series of bad decisions. It wasn't until the end whether we thought we should have even done it at all. And possibly in retrospect, it would have been good to do the consoles, but we should have done mobile first, because that's what it was. And I've got quite a few other points here which goes further into that. But that's how we ended up doing the ports, yes.
I have a question.
Mr.
Yes. But at what point did you start developing that story? The story that surrounds the development of the game is obviously that of, you know, being a family.
Yes.
Being a, you know,
yes.
Yeah. When did that enter into the
That was actually before the prototype. So and somewhere between me going, hey, it would be really cool to do this, that was still during the development of our first title that shall not be named. Our first... Stop running! It has nothing to do with running. Stop it. It's got a terrible title. We shouldn't have called it that.
You're a mean man, Jason.
No, it's my eldest daughter's fault. It was her idea. Anyway.
Called something like Let's Little Jog and Get Into Shape or something like that. Yeah. Let's Lose Weight.
Friendly jogging
reasons.
Guy.
Yeah.
That's what it was called. But anyway, it was between that moment and the initial. So when we took it to the first PAX Oz, we had already started knowing what it was,
right.
What it was about, and that was over 6 months. It's one of the reasons why game development takes so long, which is part of Tiny Whiny.
Ah.
By the way, you have the flag, and I'm done talking.
Okay. Well, for the sake of the guy in front of me, why don't we do Unity 5, Is a Land of Lies, since I'm a fair and just man.
Aww.
Very nice of you. See the quotation marks around this? That's because it's a quote. And it's not my quote. It's a Brisbane developer. Who maybe got a bit cranky one day and tweeted this. I won't say. One of the toughest ports in the entire process. Now we're doing PC, Windows, Mac, Linux, PS4, Windows, and Microsoft, Xbox One, Wii U, Android, and iOS. One of the hardest ports was Unity 4 to Unity 5. You all use Unity, I imagine. This is a Unity meetup group. Can anyone tell me what the good version of Unity 5 is? Give me a version number, please. The one without bugs, you know, the one that you can ship products with on all platforms? Anyone? No, because there isn't fucking one. And that's on top. And playing that game, look, when you're doing consoles, your problem is exacerbated. Now, I can't say too much because a lot of the APIs and whatnot is locked behind very strict legal walls, and I do respect that. But you do not have the luxury of just sitting on a version that works, if there is such a version of 5 that works anyway. You're often forced to upgrade. Yep.
Why were you forced to upgrade? Why didn't you just stay on 4.6 when you realised that 5 was such a catastrophe? Now, this is probably advice I could have given myself too,
yeah.
But... when you upgraded to 5,
absolutely
everything
absolutely.
Broke.
Why didn't we
came up on the screen
4?
And said you're an idiot and that kind of stuff that 5 did?
Yeah.
Why not just say screw it?
Yeah.
Go back to the 4.6 and
consoles.
Continue. It didn't support consoles in 4.6?
No. When you hear me talk like this and look to the side, there's just stuff, which means you can't. I'm sorry, because, as I said, there's info I can't just go blah. But yeah, you can't stay on a version of your choice if you're going to shift to consoles for reasons. You need to be fairly current. Everyone here who's shipped on consoles is going, yes, of course. And everyone else is going...
Right, and are you saying that there are confidential technical requirements?
Yeah, there's confidential technical stuff, which means I can't tell you why, but you just have to take my word for it, and that you cannot sit on a working version. You have to be fairly current to release on
this. This is a Unity requirement, I bet.
It's a...
Oh, for God's sake, help us out here, people. We're all developers.
It's just a thing that you do. It's just a thing.
4.6 had an end of life.
Yeah.
What, 3 minutes after 5 came out?
No, but...
It's just a thing.
It's a thing.
I'm sorry, we don't want to be we're in the console developers club.
There is no way that a technical requirement like this would fall under NDA, guys.
Everything falls under NDA.
Yeah,
everything does, actually. Yeah.
They put a chip in their brain.
Pretty sure Jason has probably made 2 or 3 of them so far. Right?
Yeah, actually, I probably have got... Well, I was meant to say that at the start. Anyone who actually understands the NDA and legal requirements, if you could just yell at me before I say something I shouldn't, that'd be great. But yeah, no, you just have to take our word for it. If you're going to ship on consoles, you need to have a fairly recent version. And that is a continuous bugbear. Because even when you've made the big upgrade to 5, say it's 5.1 and you're happy with it,
if you're slow, like I am, you can't stay on it. You will probably be forced to upgrade during the course of development. And maybe slightly different versions for each platform.
Oh, which certainly.
You will try to make work with the same code base. Are you getting a little glimpse into hell yet?
I had so much hair before I did this.
I've
worked with similar concepts with Novell and Microsoft, but not in the gaming space.
Yeah.
But the notion of having a non-disclosure agreement about what version of Unity you're supposed to use sounds like absolute
bullshit.
It's
why. It's the why.
Yeah.
I can't see the why.
Alright.
Because then you'd know...
But I want to be on the record saying I'm not satisfied with that concept.
I haven't signed it.
When you review the video, you can put a thumbs down.
I will, just for this.
Would not answer my...
No,
you've got
absolutely.
A flag.
I'm tweeting.
Jesus.
The Stark family is full of... What is it? A land of lies.
It's a land of lies.
age-old game dev community pattern of taking a developer out to a bar one day.
You have to physically get the flag. You have to get up and you have to physically get the flag.
Watch the flag.
I learned a lot of... one of the reasons why I started becoming confident in my abilities as a coder, because I'm entirely self-taught. My professional life has only been an artist or art director, primarily an animator, and everyone knows that animators can't code. That joke's a bit too.
Right, coders
are He's an animator, he's a fraud too. One of the reasons why I started becoming confident of my abilities to code was because I could code around the awful bugs Unity 5 had. I could track them down, and I could do really clever hacks to work around them. And that's when I started to feel clever and like I was a competent coder, is because I could fight Unity and win. So thanks for that. It's just a random selection of random bugs. A lot of them hidden things like colliders spitting out on trigger events twice. Sometimes changing the so you wouldn't know what would happen. Gemma, there's this section where she fans blow and she floats, and then sometimes she gets stuck in her float animation and float off the level, and you go, why did that happen? And but you'd have to write the code in such a way that it would detect if the bug went away, it would continue to work. Because I might have to upgrade to a version of Unity where they might fix it or change the behavior. There's lots of things, but the port from 4 to 5 was easily the hardest one. I would rather have ported to the PC to Xbox One than 4 to 5. That was pretty brutal and awful. I still don't know if we've got the performance back either. Does anyone know for sure if 5, any version of 5 is as fast as what 4 was? We should pull out old versions.
That's what you're doing, which platform you're on.
Yeah, which platform? I know Linux, I haven't gotten a version of Linux out yet. I worked really hard to get the updated version out, because we shipped with a big bug on PC that gradually slowed the game down the longer you played it. It's okay, we didn't think people would play the game for long. We were wrong. I played it for ages. So I did the version 5 upgrade, and that took me quite a while. I shipped it out before Christmas, and then we learned that it was even slower on Linux. It was slower on Linux with the bug fixed than what it was with the bug in Unity 4. I've done a few more versions with later builds of Unity, and they're still not there. The graphics API is still garbage. It's garbage. Listening, it's garbage.
There's one Linux developer, and he's very diligent. Geez, we'll put you in touch with him.
Yeah.
So much as mentioned.
Anyway.
So.
My question's actually answered during that. So if anyone else has a question. Okay.
What was your question?
It was, I'll change it slightly. So how many times during development have you upgraded?
Have I upgraded?
Have you changed just from how many times? And
okay.
What was the shortest amount of time between two upgrades that you had to do?
Ooh, okay. Well, the project was started in Unity 3.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
That hurts already.
I never updated the animation system Which means it's a horrible game. Certainly horrible games would ship with the old animation system. That joke's for Tim too. it's done the trick. It started in 3, upgraded to 4 seamlessly, absolutely seamlessly. All versions of 4 were fairly robust and seamless, as I was saying before the talk to someone. When you saw the upgrade button and just click it, I wouldn't even think. Like, people would go, well, you shouldn't do that, that's bad practice. I go, whatever. It's stable as, the new version's always going to be better. 4 to 5 was fairly catastrophic. We put that off as long as possible, and we really hoped to ship in 4, and we did not. That was well over a year ago, so we really missed that deadline. The shortest amount of time, so then, I can't remember, we did several versions of 5, because they fixed various things on the consoles, yes.
Would it be accurate to say that... because of circumstances outside of your control, you had to upgrade the editor maybe once a month?
Yeah, nearly that much. Probably the shortest was a month sometimes. And I talk about, what are these, what are they? Timey-wimey, slippery slidey is one of the points in that. It's one of the things that get you, once you start being slower than a certain point, other factors start bogging you down. One of them is how often you have to upgrade all your tools and possibly deal with bugs because of that. So if you can be fast, that's good. But I think that's the end of my complaining about Unity 5 for now, because I'm tired and I need to recover.
Oh, no. I heard something about the Land of Lies.
Yes.
Is that... it'd say the majority of the useful features you even want out of 5 didn't even happen until, like, several major versions later.
Yeah.
Which is, like, that was a major problem.
It was pretty bad. I mean, for us, the game was designed around 3 anyway, so extra features don't really help us. It's like, we're not using... Oh, God, the GUI was in, like, 4, wasn't it? 4.6 had the GUI. I don't even know what new features Unity 5 has.
I mean, personally, I'm more thinking about like promises that were made about the way the engine would work in general.
Yeah.
That are still not.
Yeah, that's
fulfilled,
right.
Even in the current version.
It was going to be super fast.
Yeah.
And it's not. It's not
also on 5, you might find SSAO is the thing that's killing performance on PC builds. That was bad.
Yeah,
that it costs like 10 times as much for some reason.
Yeah. Yeah. There's lots of broken bits.
Yeah,
go.
I have a friend.
This is just going to turn into 2 hours of us all complaining.
This is us preparing ourselves for Unity 5.
Oh, aren't you on it yet?
We are, but we're...
I have a friend that released a game. That was part of a team that released a game.
Yeah.
And we found that... My friend found... that you had to bypass certain parts of Unity to get to the metal. In your experience, have you had to do that?
No, because I'm not good enough coder.
That's good.
Yeah. What parts in particular? Like things like
so my friend
doing things like doing your own rolling your own particle setups or
like bypassing Unity's input system and going to the metal completely.
Oh yeah, yeah, that's cool.
The
that's cool.
Kits of the respective console.
That's not a bad idea.
I
have
got milliseconds out of it.
Yeah, Your friend got milliseconds out of it. Yeah, it is. Yeah, when you're squeezing every CPU cycle, inputs are massive overhead. I have noticed that myself. We go through in control.
Yeah.
And that's what you use too.
Yeah.
I would recommend everyone, because in control's, because he's not a console developer and he doesn't have access to the console APIs. So his implementation of the console support is less than optimized.
I wrote the profiles for the Xbox One and PS4 controllers.
Right.
For in control.
This is what I recommend
friend.
For doing in control. My
friend
did
it.
My friend.
Your friend did it. This is what I do with in control. I was really inspired. They have an OUYA input manager. Excuse me, burping up coke. And when I saw that, the drink, no. When I saw the year input manager, it sort of all clicked with me. And what I've done is actually, instead of going through the Unity input manager, which supports mice, keyboards, a billion controllers. I write my own input manager for the specific console and only spawn that, and then write my own specific devices for it. And that way I can get events when they're connected, disconnected. I can use the APIs rather than going through Unity things and pass all that into the in-control system. And, yeah, shave off milliseconds. So it looks like we've done similar things.
Well, but we bypassed it. We
you bypassed it completely. You just
we
went directly
calling
into
it. Directly into
yeah, nice.
Native. Native.
Okay, no, I haven't done native. That'd be faster still.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's crazy. Yeah, the input is also garbage. you have the flag.
Oh, shit.
Ask your friend.
We have. Was it worth it? We have brains being squeezed, timey-wimey, slippery-slidey, markets, and platforms. Ask me anything.
Wow.
We have instructions, question mark, so many forms, design, 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 and grab bag of tech tricks, which I think I mostly use talking about improv.
Well, I don't like Doctor Who, so... Markets.
Now, how did you know that's a statement from Doctor Who, if you don't like it?
From me.
You can't avoid Doctor Who.
First half.
It's everywhere. Anyway, markets, greater than platforms.
Markets
for 200.
Markets for platforms. Okay.
Yeah.
Because we're such good business people, this has only really made itself clear to us after we started releasing, which is stupid because it should have been part of our plan from the start, which of course it was. An Xbox One isn't just a different machine in a box. PS4 is not just a different machine. It's not a PC that sits under your television. It is a different market, and that's exceedingly important. And this is why I said a while ago what we should have done is we should have stuck to our guns and released it on iOS first, because it's called Ninja Pizza Girl. It's a story of bullying from the perspective of an adolescent girl. It is not made for Steam. Technically, it works on Steam just fine. The average Steam user does not respond well to that sort of story. Now, there have been people who have played it and have been immensely touched to us and written to us personally and given us very, very touching stories about their experiences with it. But the overall market impression is it's not for them. And you know what? It was not for them. We didn't look at the Steam market, which seems to mainly consist of angry 17-year-old boys. That's why your radio show appeals to them so much. It really does. Maybe they're not all angry. Anyway, it's not the game for them. And that was our lead platform. And that was really dumb. And releasing on the consoles, even though the console is still not made for consoles. You know, when you think about it, you know, adolescent girls are not your primary Xbox One user base. But even the difference from Steam to consoles is profound. All of a sudden, a lot more welcoming, a lot more... Instead of people sitting back and going, Ninja Pizza Girl, can't look up her skirt? No? where we seriously had people angry that our main character wasn't sexy. Because it was the only reason they wanted a female protagonist. And they felt tricked. And they would get personally upset at us. You go, no, she's a girl, what is wrong with you? Whereas on console, even though the market base is still mainly older guys, like 20-something, 30-year-old guys, they're still much more willing to give it a chance, which is profoundly different. Yes?
I was just generally curious.
I noticed you moved from the front to back there. Is that
I can get access to the flag.
Oh, okay. Okay.
That's the only thing in my
house. How many people told you on Steam that they wouldn't buy your game because they can't play as a guy?
So you can't play a guy? No one.
No one. That's good.
No one. We just got a lot of people upset because they felt they had been tricked because she wasn't hot.
That's so fucked up. Oh my god.
Welcome
so
to
fun.
Steam.
That is so fucked
up. Now, I don't want to say everyone on Steam is a monster because that's not true, and we do have a lovely fan base and they are wonderful. And there are nice games on Steam, but because we're not an established genre, people don't quite know what to make of us. We do really fight through. We're not the typical Steam game. And yeah, consoles, even though I'd say we're not the typical console game either, it's a much warmer reception.
I also have another question about release ordering. So you're talking about platforms and markets, and
yep.
how it's much more important to pay attention to who actually plays.
Yeah, yeah, pay attention to your, not the technology,
yeah.
but the people who actually play that device.
But there's also, like, in my experience, there's been
yeah.
a perception of games changes based on where it's coming from and not what the game
True.
Is.
True.
So you're talking about releasing on mobile first,
mm.
but personally, I view it the other way, where after the game we just released,
yeah.
I would never release on mobile first. I would probably not release on PC first because of the negativity that the markets, like the people on these markets,
yeah.
see of the game. Like if someone sees a game coming from mobile to PC or console, there's a
yeah,
lot of negativity.
Yeah, that is, we had this conversation ages ago in PAX Oz. I don't know if
yeah.
it was the last PAX Oz or the PAX Oz before that.
Yeah.
It was the PAX Oz before that we had this conversation about release order, and you were very convincing. And I think it really depends on the product you're releasing. I have seen a few people go from mobile to Xbox One, and if they're successful enough, no one cares. It's really a case of enough success breaks all the rules. But yeah, it might have also helped because we're not well known enough on Steam for the console users to have heard of us before, so for all they know, it's a brand new game. But it's much warmer. I really wish we'd led, you know, we had it in mind. We knew that we had to go where the girls and the kids were playing. It's still primarily a game for young adults. And we're not going to platforms with the young adults. We're going to platforms with the angry boys. Although consoles seem to be a much happier place. And the one platform where we keep getting asked, like actively harassed over when we're coming out for is the Wii U. So we're hoping that the Wii U, with its sort of more kid-friendly, family-friendly approach, that's going to be the... Once again, it's not the technology. Who cares about the technology? You can make a game run on anything. Unless it's Tim's game, because he puts a billion bullets in everywhere. It's not a billion. It was only 8,000?
4,000 Shadow.
With Shadows. 8,000 objects, yes. That's fine. Yeah, think about your market. That's the most important thing in the world. And then... look at the device and make your game to fit that. I would say that was the one lesson that we... Another one of the many lessons that we should have known from the start. Anyway, you're holding the flag?
Oh, I just... because I was the last person to have it.
Yeah.
Oh, you done?
Yeah.
All right, let's go so many forums.
You know this.
Well, I only know about half of what you know.
True. Well, it's pretty much the same as what you know, but doubled. Alright. I keep talking about how dumb we are, and Nicole said it's very important you don't go there and just keep talking about how dumb you are. And I've done it.
Success.
Let's build a little bit of more respect back. We released Ninja Pizza Girl on PC about 10 months ago. So you go, so it's taken you 10 months to do the port for two platforms. You're pretty crap. I mean, you can think it, you don't say it because you're polite people, but you think that's pretty slow, that's pretty crap. Okay, we have not been full time doing the port. Because after the PC release, we realized that we should, this is once again, we should realize this at the start of our company. Don't just try to make a living making your one dream game. Do other stuff as well. Take on jobs. Stop saying no when people offer you jobs and start saying yes. Because then you're more robust, you can expand and grow, and maybe one day become a little defiant, mini-defiant, just like Morgan. It'd be great. Morgan's not here because he has bad things to do, because he's expanded into defiant. That's fantastic. So, after we released on PC, we started taking on other jobs, which was great, except we lost 1 month going to Unity 5. We spent another 2 months doing full-time on another project, and we're actually working for Joel and Cheryl. Does everyone know Joel and Cheryl?
Prideful Sloth.
Everyone know that project? Anyway, we're working on that. And we're working on that 3 days of the week, meaning that it's two people, 2 days of the week, porting three platforms, across three regions, because you go do US, Europe, and Japan, and we do have a Japanese publisher, and we have to do a separate Japanese, localized Japanese version as well. So that's the bit where you're getting pressed. well done. So that's why we're... Yes, thank you. Thank you. Thank you enough. Okay, so many forms. How does that relate to so many forms? Okay, well, I have single-handedly done all the tech stuff. And Nicole has just filled out the forms, communicated with, like, the publisher and Sony Europe and Sony America and the Japanese publisher and Nintendo Europe and Nintendo America and Microsoft. And she's found out, you know, the instructions on how to actually upload builds, you know, so. The work split has been about 50-50. I have done very slightly more work than her. That's how much paperwork and communication is involved. So, yeah, I sort of started at the start of this process. It was all like, oh, I'm doing the ports. And Nicole's, you know, like, you know, whatever she does. And by the end of it now, I go, no, we've done the ports. And she has so much knowledge. And if I had to sit down and do a console port, I would be completely lost without the things that she knows. I'd be able to get something running. I wouldn't be able to submit it to anyone. I wouldn't be able to go through the... Yeah, exactly. It is absolutely critical. A lot of people think, oh, okay, I'm going to do console ports. I'm going to need all this technical knowledge. What you need is someone really organized and really patient. Nicole compares it to basically doing very complex taxes.
I agree.
Yeah. Yeah. It is excruciating. So at the bare minimum, don't make the one person do both, because their mind will probably snap real quick. But even if you split it up into two, that's the sort of workload you're looking at. So yeah, forms. Lots and lots of forms. That was cool. That was interesting. I can't go into details of them. I do know there'll be a lot of chasing up. They aren't user-friendly. These are not consumer organizations. They're not public storefronts. These are backdoors for professionals and thus demand a little bit more effort from you to utilize. There, was that good enough? Did I break any laws? That was good. So just be prepared for that and have someone solely for that job. And that job is just as important as the techie guy with the techie hat. This techie hat's not going to get anything on the store without that.
When Nicole's not in a fever dream, she's around to help people with some of these platforms?
Yeah.
Understanding some of these forms?
Yeah.
Specifically me as a person.
Oh, you?
Yeah.
How would we help you?
You release me.
Of course. Any tweet. Oh, it's a catch.
Okay.
Yeah. Of course we'll help you.
You can have my soul.
Yeah, but don't be silly. Indy 5 already has your song. Actually, no, that reminds me of a little thing. Don't stare at sales figures. Who's stared at their sales figures? Yeah, don't stare at it. Sucks the soul right out of your body. I was saying this before. What can happen to you? What can possibly be a good result? Because either the sales figures are crap, and you feel terrible, and you keep clicking the refresh button, waiting for them to magically go up, or they're going up, and you live in constant fear of them plateauing and going down. Just don't look at your sales figures. Look at them monthly or something. Or get someone else entirely to look at them and try to judge by their facial expressions. Do not stare at your sales figures. We still don't know the sales figures for our console release. And the reason why we don't know yet is because it would be too early to get a really concrete idea of how it's going to perform over its lifetime. And we can't do anything with that knowledge. We don't need to know. How much did we sell in the first week? Who cares? We've got solid finances. We don't need that. There's no way we could react to that knowledge. And it would just cripple us. Yeah, go on.
Hello. Yes, you can.
Yeah,
you can.
I do.
You can adjust your marketing.
Sales.
Adjust your advertising.
Oh,
I'm not sure what else
my
you're
advertising.
Doing.
You're right. I could move my billions from this guy to
yes,
my billions.
Billions.
There's no
advertising.
There's no advertising.
Well, in that case, no, you can't do
anything. No, we can't do anything. Yeah, that's right. If we had the cash to target markets with paid advertising, I would employ someone, and it would be his job to stare at the sales figures, and I could judge by his facial expression how we were going. And if we were going badly, I would just sack him at the end of the month.
Obviously. It would be his fault.
Yeah, exactly. It would be entirely that.
Entirely. Wouldn't be the game.
But yeah, we there's nothing we can do. Obviously, we just keep promoting it as best we can, and we still interact. But I find it's much easier to focus on that without just staring at this number, this bar going up and down
right.
all the time. It's like, we can still go out there, we can still be proactive, we can still get a good idea of who's responding to the product, just from the social media buzz and the people that we're talking to. And that's more important than numbers, because we can react to that, but the number going up and down.
But if you
sucks this all right, have
you? If you have demographics attached to the numbers,
you don't.
But you don't.
Where?
Really?
I have a sales figure.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, fuck that.
Yeah. Exactly.
Well, not even country by country?
Yeah, we have country by country, but what are we going to do with that? We sold 300 in Kazakhstan, that country I don't know. I apologize to every Middle Easterner. Very offensive. We sold 50 in France. Good, we should include a free baguette with every... I don't know. It's like, seriously, what can you do?
Localization?
Maybe, but once again, I'd wait till the end of the month, because, I mean, we haven't shipped with localization. So we'll wait, you know, a month or two, and you go, oh, no, there's serious numbers in Europe. Maybe it's worth doing localization. But after a week, that's just going to... What's that going to mean? We sold a couple hundred in France, quick! It's called Ninja Baguette Girl.
I think also the talk, the name of this talk is important because multiple platforms, you're not just dealing with like different people reporting at different rates, but then there's also different regions within each platform as well that report at different rates.
Real business, like if Morgan was listening to this, he'd probably have a heart attack and slap me upside the head, but we just do not have the resources. Like if we had people to deal with this, but really we're stretched completely thin doing what we're doing at the moment, and we don't have the money, sales or employees to react to sales figures, so all it would do is suck the soul out of your body. How are you doing, Gross? How's your soul?
It's
my one advice for everyone: release your game, engage with your audience, be cheery and positive, and don't look at your sales for a while.
Peaks different times during the day.
See, you should know that. See, this is what I'm talking about. This again. 5 o'clock. 5 o'clock. The sales are up. Okay, we've got to do something at 5. What are we doing at 5? I don't know. We've got to start trailing off at 6. I can. And you can't live like that. You just can't live like that.
After a Steam sale, I like to check to see if I got a Batman shape or not. Because sometimes it's really neat with the ears the same size, and sometimes it's a bit lopsided, and I always feel a bit annoyed.
Yeah. No, I've been slightly happier during development than Nicole, and that's because Nicole looks at the money more. Because it doesn't matter what direction it goes, it's a real emotional cost. This is only advice for small indies, by the way. Anyone, a real business person, don't listen to me. Well, you won't listen to me, will you? Who's got the flag?
Oh, really?
And what's the time? No one got home.
It's 7:52.
Windows start?
7.
Oh, okay, cool. Cool. We can keep going.
Well, what about the tech tricks? That sounds like fun. Or did
tech tricks
ran
is
out
very
of
small. I've almost run out of tech tricks.
Well,
my
we
in control,
minutes,
that was my
so
biggest tech trick.
Do we only have 8 minutes?
No.
Okay.
Oh, well, grab a bag of tech tricks. What have I got in here? Aha! Yeah. Just got a note here that says console performance. Right. Where's the people who I asked to stop me from talking before I said anything that would get me into trouble with legals?
I'm sure Nicole will appreciate if I say yes.
Okay, so I can't say that. Okay. Yeah.
Do you
want to
phone in a friend?
No, look. I apologise, because just thinking about legals and bringing up legals in this topic, it's really hurt my whole talk performance. In fact,
just quote some Digital Foundry articles on Unity-based games on consoles. That's better telling people.
Yeah. Yeah, now you're probably all feeling immensely disappointed at this stage, and can't believe why I'm being so unfathomably poor. And I do apologise. Because when someone performs this badly, they really should apologise. And they definitely shouldn't get defensive and blame the developer. And with that, I'll move on. Yeah, so three people have developed on consoles with Unity and they're laughing. Everyone else is going, I don't know what just happened. I think he had a stroke. Let's just say, because you never know what platform you end up porting to, like maybe for some reason you'll end up porting to a crappy Android device from 2012. Or something which performs just as badly, even though it really doesn't look like it should from the outside. Yes, Tim.
Without going into NDA details, can you cite a Unity system that you never expected to run like crap that did?
No Unity system runs like crap, Tim. They're all great.
Oh, okay.
I mean, look at Cactus on the PS4. That looks fantastic.
Yeah,
so that must have been pretty effortless.
No surprises.
For you. Yeah, no surprises. No.
One quick deploy.
All of them?
As promised.
All of them. One of the things that I never did with Ninja Pizza Girl, because it's a side scroller, and it's basically a game. Well, it's like Damsel. I mean, you've pretty much ripped off. Entirely.
You made it sexy, though. God.
It's true, actually. It's a completely different thing. I heard you when we were on that panel together. I loved what you said. You know, obviously, there's a lot of ideas and mythos around vampires, the sexuality, and whatnot. And we weren't interested in any of that.
Yeah.
That was fantastic what you said. I just loved it. You know, it really reminds me of the games, of the movies I used to watch with Raven. She would watch anything if it was about one woman kicking the ass of many, many men. And we would sit down and watch these movies that were pretty dire but awesome, like a female version of a trashy 80s movie. Anyway, that's completely unrelated. One of the things I never did, because my game is basically a game from the 80s. It's side-scrolling, it's got like 7 enemies on screen at once, you only see a tiny slice of the world at any time. I never really bothered with scene management. I just let all the enemies run all the time, because it's like, oh no, it'll be updating 50 enemies at once, big deal. Yeah, it was. It really was. And I never sat down to properly do scene management. So everything manages itself individually, which means everything's got triggers switching itself off, which anyone, that's dumb. It's dumb. I should have sat down, I should have done a proper grid-based system where it activated the grid it was in and the neighboring grids. It should have been an offset grid, because then an offset grid, it's like a hexagonal pattern that only has 6 neighbors instead of 8 neighbors. I see everyone's eyes crossing. Am I just going gibberish? Okay, anyway, I should have done scene management. And I didn't, because I assumed there would be power to spare. And there was on the PC, and there wasn't on any of the other platforms. Without going into too much details, I mean, my platforms go from PC to iPad 3. So you should develop as if you have no CPU whatsoever. Much, much, much lower than you think, and you should be absolutely tight, and you should spend a little while just living in the Unity profiler. Because you may be surprised about what costs you. Because sometimes a particle system that's miles off screen and not updating, and you assume that's completely free, and it won't be, or there'll be something that's just not animating, but the animator update will cost you. So, yeah, lots of things that you assume, oh, well, it's off screen, the scene manager, the Unity will take care of it, you know, it won't cost me anything. Have a look, because even though that comes up as 0.05 milliseconds on your PC profiler, that could be 5 milliseconds on some of other platforms, because they are not as optimal.
So is it more of a flat FPS decrease, or is it like some systems will randomly take longer?
Yeah, if you're doing as many different platforms as me, yeah, you don't know what will be expensive on which one.
So it's not like, oh, aim for this FPS on PC and then you're good for the other consoles.
Yeah, nah.
Cool.
Ninja Pizza Girl will run at about 500 frames per second uncapped on a PC, and it's not fast enough.
Is that a Unity thing? That's an NDA thing. Got it.
No, it's Unity. It's good.
Okay, cool.
And it's varying levels of garbage in its various implementations.
So is it, would if you were like, all right, next project on a console, are you sticking with Unity?
Probably, yeah. So I guess you've actually forced me to say good things about Unity. So
you haven't yet.
I will. And it's a really good question.
My question was going to be, will you switch to something else like Unreal?
Absolutely not. I think the productivity gains outweigh all of the everything else. Because I can go into the profiler, and I can spend one day. In one day, I got the frame rate on one of my platforms from 15 to 60. I'm not going to do that in Unreal. And we may as well not say other platform. We may as well say Unreal, because what other one is there? I want to hit all these platforms. There's Unreal, there's Unreal. Unreal, I've used it a little bit before, and it's a great engine, and you can probably get much more AAA. I'm not going to make a AAA game. So it's far better for me to design something that's very simple, something that's simple and attractive, rather than something that's AAA, because I would blow all of Ninja Pizza Girl's budget on the Batmobile. And that's not an exaggeration. I know the guy who worked on Batman, he told me the specs of the Batmobile and what went into it, and went, yeah, that's the budget of Ninja Pizza Girl. So it's ridiculous. So I don't need something that will push a lot of polys. I don't need something that will give me high-end effects. I need something that I, a schmuck animator, can bring out a game on a Linux. Mac, by the way, don't release on Linux. That's stupid. PC, Mac, Linux, blah, 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 blah. I did all that. And that's amazing. It is fairly magical. More magical stories. I had the Ninja Pizza Girl version on the Wii U. I had the Wii U version up and running in 2 days. A lot of it was broken. It certainly wasn't shippable. It took me a lot longer to get there, but it was one. And one of those days was fixing shaders, which was hilarious because I called up Bruno. Who knows Bruno? Bruno. Great. He's in Tasmania. He did the shaders, and I Skyped him up. I said, Bruno, it's all pink. When something's broken, it just goes pink on the Wii U. It's all pink, and he basically laughed at me. And he said, well, you have to debug that then. I don't do shaders, Bruno. You do the shaders. He goes, yeah, just go through the shader. Turn things off line by line until it works. And then you'll find the line that's broken. Then you can fix it. Oh, my God. And it was a day of painstakingly going through text files, commenting this out. And he was working. We just had Skype open. And he'd go, did that work? I go, no, it's still pink. He goes, yeah, I'll try the next one. That was my tech artist helping me. But after that one day, 2 days, I had Ninja Pizza Girl running on the Wii U. That's amazing. It was similar stories for all the platforms. It was like a matter of days, bang, I've got a version working on these consoles. That is magical. The support base is magical. If you have a problem, chances are some other Unity user has had that problem. Little proviso, though, it gets a lot harder on console stuff because you cannot Google PS4 Unity bug because of all the NDAs and stuff, and so your community shrinks. But even with that subset, it's still a good community, and there's still a lot of people out there, and they're still monstrously helpful. Though it is really funny to find Dan from Defiant in the forums. Like, you'll be typing along and go, who's this doofus? Oh, it's Dan. He's made a lot of helpful posts, and it's really good to see other people on there having similar problems to you. But yeah, it's magical. I say it's crap. I complain about the performance. I complain about the bugs. But damn, nothing else can do it. I mean, you dream of basically something which is just as magical as Unity, but really performant and really bug-free, but it doesn't exist. and it is by far the best option we have at the moment. Now I sound like an indie ad, and I hate it.
At least we'll keep getting pizza.
You'll keep getting pizza. But yeah, no, I absolutely wouldn't even consider it. Good question. I don't know if I have any other tips or tricks. Oh, yeah, for God's sakes, people, stop using for each. Use for each. Why? Are we in control? Hey, garbage. Lots of garbage. You know what? You know what garbage is. Who knows what garbage is? Yes, you know what garbage is. Garbage is bad. Stop making garbage and going, it's okay. It's not okay. It's terrible.
I'm a bad programmer.
It's in control, which is a third-party thing. Leaked. It just made garbage, like vast amounts of it. And I am an animator. I am not a clever coder. Yep.
I say, don't use Link either. That's bad.
Yeah, what? You'll see tutorials about people championing Link. It's so bad. I'm going to get spots on my face and get proper coder rage. Dude, don't touch this. Because, yeah, I can go back to sort of saying Unity is garbage. The version of Mono it uses is so ancient and bug-riddled. For each, that the clever pants of you might be going, but for each doesn't make garbage, depending on the type of the iterator. Yes, you're wrong. Because the version of Mono that Unity uses has a bug in it that it always makes garbage. So for each is just bad. It's okay, maybe it's seen in it. But don't put it in an update. Like in control does. It's fine. It's a one-line fix. You turn a for each into a for, and all of a sudden it's servers spewing out kilobytes of garbage a frame. It doesn't do any. And you go, I should write to the guy. He seems a nice guy. Screw him. Everyone else, I can sound clever. So you just go through it. You'll find the line. Just go into your profiler. Once again, the wonderful Unity profiler. And you'll find the line. Just change it to a for loop. It's fine. Don't use for each. Don't use coroutines because they make garbage. So very small amounts, but be careful with them. I suppose you can use them, but I just wouldn't. There's other alternatives. I know it's easier. I wouldn't because, once again, they make garbage and the execution order is weird.
Coroutines can also insert some very difficult to track crashes on certain platforms.
Yeah, they do weird stuff because it's a bit black box because you're using Unity's magical coroutine handling system, and I wouldn't. Having said that, Ninja Pizza Girl's riddled with them because I was figuring this out as I was making it, and the code base is 4 years old. But they would be my techie advices. Don't do that. And just be really, really tight with your development. If you're going to go to the consoles at all, just be as performant as possible. Do things like have a scene manager. Have things like don't have anything updating. If you can't see it, it shouldn't exist. It should be deactivated. It should be switched off. It should be gone. Because you don't want to be paying for more than what you can see, even if it is a really simple game. And surely powerful modern hardware can... Don't assume anything. Maybe powerful modern hardware can. The implementation's getting better all the time. But maybe it can't, and there's no reason not to be careful. That's pretty much it. I'm sure that... You have to get the flag. It's part of the game. Come on, get up! Don't pass it to him!
What is this? I was getting ready to throw it. Yeah. So pick it out of hand.
Wave it proudly. Proudly.
Did you feel a bit of a, what's the word? Not culture shock, like a shock. The platforms require you to use a hell of a lot more asynchronous code than what you would have used during the making of the game? Is that a big deal?
Yeah, I guess that's another thing. Yeah, this goes in here too. A grab bag of tech tricks. This is artist tech tricks. Using normal Unity on the public platforms, it's okay to be dumb. It's okay to live in the fluffy C-sharp land where you don't really have to understand about compiling things. It's not really okay to be that ignorant in console land. You just need that little bit more coderiness. I don't know about did you find that?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just the expectations of what you're meant to know go up. I think you know, that's been pretty vague, but I can't actually remember your question. I've distracted myself. So
asynchronous.
Yes.
Like platforms
yes.
going.
Yes, absolutely. Because obviously we can't talk about the APIs, but a lot of the APIs do require asynchronous, which was really good. It was really good practice for me to go, oh, all right, okay. Because you're used to, actually my leaderboards are done pretty badly and all the async calls are wrapped in coroutines. So don't do that. Don't do that. Embrace the proper coding patterns and get callbacks and make it all nice and tidy. But yes, this, as soon as you start touching the consoles, you start, even the code which is still C# starts to look a bit more structured like C++. It looks a little bit more serious. And just brace yourself for that. If you've been, you know, confident with your skills and it's okay, I've mastered this C# stuff, because it's pretty much as simple as Commodore 64 Basic, really. It is. Because that's where I went. I coded Commodore 64 Basic when I was a little boy. And then I did art for 30 years. And then I did C#. And I go, oh, C# is just like Commodore 64 Basic. Yes, it is. So,
bloody isn't, Jason.
It's, oh, okay, well, the structure and the concepts are completely different, but that's like the
structure and the content are different, but otherwise they're identical.
Well, just
syntax is different, but otherwise.
There's variables.
There's variables. It's easy. What's happening to the stuff doesn't matter. Just, it's fine. And then you find out about garbage, and that illusion is slowly destroyed. I can do whatever I want. The computer takes care of it. Oh, why is it stuttering every 10 frame? Well, the console's just ups that again, which is fine. You just have to educate yourself a little bit more. So just brace yourself for that if you're not. If you're a proper coder, it's fine. If you're not a proper coder, if you're coming from an artist, it's another thing that you have to deal with. And that's the end of that one. I think we'll do, what, like two more?
It's up to you.
I really want to go home. I do apologize for talking about going home a lot, but I have a 2-hour drive to home because it's a long way away. It was only 8:11, and that's fine. I normally go to sleep at 9, but it's okay. Hey, people are tweeting about me.
That's me?
Oh, lots of people. Okay, one person. It's going off. I'm going to retweet that. Well, I do also want... I don't want to go through all of them either, because I want to make these choices critical and exciting. So we'll do two more. So we have... who's got flag? You've got flag. Okay. We've got Ask Me Anything, Timey Wimey, Slippery Slidey, Brains, Was It Worth It? Was It Worth It? It's an interesting question. Instructions, Design.
Someone said, was it worth it? It's an interesting one, so I'll go with
was
that.
Was it worth it? Yeah. it's a big question. I don't know if everyone saw it. I tweeted about 2 weeks ago that I thought that maybe this talk was going to consist of me sitting in a chair with a glass of scotch, saying it was hard, just staring into space for 2 hours. I'm going to repeat something that I said earlier, and you guys all just sat there and went, eh, whatever. But 3 days a week, we work for someone else. But 2 days a week, we handle the porting of 3 platforms in lots of different territories. And it turns your brain into a pretzel. This is actually this section here. It was extremely hard. I thought prior to this that the Kickstarter was the hardest thing I'd ever done in my life. Little aside, don't do a Kickstarter. Unless someone's put a gun to your head and say, I'm going to kill you and everyone you've ever loved unless you do a Kickstarter, don't do a Kickstarter. We're game developers, so we face that sort of situation often. So, so that's fine. I understand. You've done it.
I totally agree.
Yeah.
It's horrible. Don't do it.
Yeah. Yeah. And you're not allowed to say it's horrible because saying it's horrible is insulting the amazing people who have backed you and supported you. So, you know, when people say, oh, how was the Kickstarter? You have to say, oh, it was just amazing to have all that support. It is amazing to have all that support, but what you're really thinking is, I think I died 2 days ago, and my body corpse is just moving around answering these questions. It is so hard. The last few months have been harder. So, probably yes. Probably yes, it was worth it, because I have a game on a console now, which is still magical, because I'm not a business person, because I make stupid decisions. It's still awesome. You can play Ninja Pizza Girl on a frickin' Xbox. That's cool. And the people have been amazing. The people who do like the game, they have been great. And it has made us more money. And even with our incredibly limited resources and our non-spectacular sales, it still works out. I think, I mean, as I said, I haven't looked at sales data, but from the guesstimates, from the response, judging on the Steam, I'm going to guess that it was worth it financially. And now we have fairly rare skill sets. We can port on all three platforms, and we're going to port on mobile. And we've taken the one project through all of those, and we've squeezed them into all those different boxes, and we have those, we physically have those dev kits in our house. I can't show you a picture of them because it's NDA, which is a shame, because I want to show you a picture of our setup because it looks so gnarly. Oh no, I don't know if I can say it looks gnarly. Gnarly didn't mean anything, it's a meaningless word. And yeah, it is going to make us money. And if you've made a game, the porting process, even though it does squeeze your brain like a pretzel, it's not the most work. You know, you've made a game. You should definitely, you know, bring it to the Xbox One, Tim. should squash those feelings you have for Microsoft deep down inside. Just bring your awesome game to another platform, because you will earn more money.
That's me, actually.
Well, it's your fault. You should definitely bring your awesome game to another platform. It's more people to play it. I don't see any reason why not to, apart from the fact that it's hard, and maybe you'll want to die sometimes. No, it's not that bad. Yeah, I would say it's worth it, even though it was crazy and it was hard. But for the skill sets and just for the money, one thing that I would recommend is don't do it with such a small team. Possibly do it. Please allocate the budget to at least have one person per platform. At least doing it so that they can focus on that one platform, and possibly maybe even have more than one person. Or if you had a full-time person, because Nicole had to do all the wrangling and all the paperwork, and she also did taxes, and she also did a lot of running business stuff as well, and she also did art for other things. So if you have one full-time person who's dedicated solely to managing the organization, the forms, the interactions with the people, that's probably reasonable. So if you're doing three platforms, have three tech people and then one other person doing it, that would be great. Doing it with less than that is probably crazy. What do you think, Tim? How crazy is it? You only did one at a time, though.
Yes. I tried.
You did one, released it, did the other. The reason why we didn't want to do that and why we did them all at the same time is because I don't think this is NDA. You submit. You do various submissions. It gets approved and gets sent back. I'm not going to submit it and then go to the beach for 2 weeks. I'm assuming you guys didn't either. But, no. Yes, you did. I saw you at Noosa hanging out.
Yeah.
So during that time, we just worked on another one. We just wanted to fill time as much as possible, and so we inevitably ended up doing the three of them at once. We would love to have done one. Yeah.
I mean, different games have extremely different technical problems.
Yeah, that's true.
So
that's true.
The problem of porting a game to different platforms and dealing with their technical requirements and languages and localization and submissions is a tiny part of some games. Issues with running on everything at once.
Yeah. Oh no, that's a really good point. I mean, I only know Ninja Pizza Girl. So if you want to talk more and expand on that, that would be really cool. I can steal your knowledge and use it as part of this talk. That'd be cool.
During our case was dictated, we ended up with a PS4 window for whatever reason. Which dictated that, and then to make sure the PS4 version was good, it needed all the focus as well.
Yeah.
So that was a...
Yeah, because you were squeezing a much bigger game into the consoles.
Yeah.
As I said, Ninja Pizza Girl is essentially was designed to run on a 3GS. It does run on a 3GS.
You had that great card earlier, and some anonymous developer, who I don't know who it was, obviously, quoted as saying Unity 5 is a land of lies.
Yes.
Which I think plays into that.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. It is quite shocking. So, yeah, no, hats off to you for your achievement. But squeezing it in and getting it right. It's a solid 60, isn't it?
Users
can't tell. Just say it's 60.
I got a mean tweet the other day. Someone said it ran terribly. I feel bad.
Oh, really? You're going to remember that for years now, aren't you? It's funny. I wonder if people would be nicer or even meaner if they knew how we were affected by their tweets. Like, if you tweeted back, "I'm going to remember that. That really hurt me. I'm going to remember that for years." Would they feel empowered and go, "Awesome,"
and
be
even
meaner?
They would multiply logarithmically.
Yeah, would it get worse, or would they actually sort of recognize you as another human being, empathize, and be much nicer?
That doesn't happen on Twitter.
My experience is normally humanizing myself makes them apologize.
Yeah.
Like, they kind of do that whole thing where they thought they were yelling into the void, and they're so shocked that someone answers back.
Yeah, well, that's what I think it is. I think that one of the reasons this is so relevant to console development. I think one of the reasons, actually it is because you spend a lot of time on social media. I think one of the reasons why people are so mean on Twitter is because they feel so disempowered and they just want to scream as loud as they can. So, yeah, we've been really lucky. Most of our users have been awesome. What were we talking about? I completely lost the train of everything. Was it worth it? Yeah, but only barely for us. It nearly wrecked us. But we were doing it with bugger all resources. Try to make sure you have the resources there for your console development. Just don't sort of go, "Oh, yeah, it'll happen," which is kind of what we did. Make sure you've set the budget aside and it's allocated and you know you have the man hours and you know you have the space to do it. And then definitely it's worth it. Try to bring it to as many platforms as is feasible. Feasible will change depending on your project and your situation. But I'd highly recommend it, yes. Yes, it was worth it. I will keep telling myself that. Who's got the flag? Okay. One more.
Okay. AMA.
Ask me anything. Easy.
Well,
we're running out of time, I figure.
Yeah, we might as well end with questions. Okay. And because you guys have played along with the rules so well, I will tell you some embarrassing stories. The first build we sent off to Sony US was in Japanese. It was just locked in Japanese. You couldn't change the language. It was just Japanese. It was all in Japanese. They got back to us and very politely QA speak said it's in Japanese. But they said, like, you know, to replicate boot title, note it is in Japanese. The expected result, title is not in Japanese. Because I just sent a build to the Japanese publisher, so look at your builds before you send them to people. That's important. Lesson learned that day.
Did you get any more time for development by sending them a build that was wrong? So that when they sent it back, you just had 2 weeks. I know of a company that did this on purpose. They left a swear word in the game. It's a Brisbane company that no longer exists. And they left it in so that they knew they would fail their TCRs, so they'd have an extra 2 weeks of development.
No, they come back to us really quickly.
I think that only works if you have a publisher and you're playing games with them. If when you're your publisher, you're just...
Yeah, you just want it done. You just want it done. And you just go, that was some time. The time we lost. So no. Any other questions? Yes, you ask where this is your last chance to learn. Geniuses of multi-platform development.
Are there any non-NDA gotchas that you would tell someone who wanted to look into releasing their game on WiiU and Xbox?
WiiU and Xbox specifically.
I mean, you know, I don't need the other information. You want.
No, just bear in mind the WiiU is obviously a lot less powerful. It's a generation behind the others. So if you're struggling to fit it into a PS4 for the WiiU, having said that, no, the WiiU community is awesome, is one thing we've noticed. We were really looking forward to releasing on WiiU because we already have heaps of people, you know, pumped for it and bugging us for it. And every time, like if we post something on our Kickstarter about the WiiU version, it will be in WiiU news sites the day after. So that's cool. That's awesome. So that's the opposite of a gotcha. That's like, release a WiiU if you can, because they're desperate for titles. Yeah?
Yeah, but to be fair, they've got nothing else to talk about for the WiiU.
Yeah, but that's cool. That means you've got an entire user base out there that's just hungry for titles. They're not turning their nose up at indie things because they have nothing else. Except for Zelda. Zelda will come.
Can I ask you just about the marketing, like how you went about positioning and promoting it, as well as price points and all that?
Price points was easy for us, because we asked our Japanese publisher, how much do you think we should charge? And they told us. We went, cool. Because we really had no idea. And it was really reassuring. In fact, that's one of the other experiences I found. When we first... When we first started our company, it was like, yeah, now we're publishers, take that, do whatever we want, yeah, we're going to express ourselves, this is cool, what do we do, what's important, is this important, I don't know, what do people want, I don't know, they keep saying opposite things, I don't know what people want, I tweet, I say, what do you want, and no one answers, and I don't know what to do. It's fantastic to defer some of that decision-making process to some, I don't know, maybe they're completely wrong. Maybe the price point we settled on was garbage, but I'm deferring to their authority. Well, we have to in Japan, so we just copied that price everywhere else.
If you could go back with the knowledge you have now, would you still port to all the platforms, or would you start a new project on the platforms that you originally...
If I could go back in time?
Yeah, with the knowledge you have.
If I could go back in time with the knowledge... There's a few things I would have done differently, but we definitely would have released on iOS first. Because that's... Also, it's funny, because I don't have that knowledge yet, but we're assuming that's going to be our strongest platform. Even then, we don't know if that's true, because maybe... And this is... Oh, this is another pro! Was it worth it? Yes! It's worth it going on as many platforms as possible if you're a teeny-weeny indie. Because your marketing multiplies against itself. Every time the Nintendo sites talk about us, we get pick up a few Steam sales. And vice versa. It's just more places talking about your game. The Xbox, just from the old Xbox indie days, has got a wonderful community of people. And so we rip through the new cycles there. That gets picked up by people with PlayStations. It gets picked up with people... with Linux versions. It was great. Don't do a Linux version. Don't do a Linux version. I want to quickly give the figures on the Linux. For every 100 copies sold on PC, we sell one Linux.
If you had done a Humble Bundle, which I think is the only reason that most people do a Linux version, because the only way to be as part of the Humble Bundle is to have a Mac, PC, and Linux version.
Oh, right. Okay.
So I just might, like, that's what I was just
that wondering. Might be a reason to do it.
But might be a reason. Yeah, okay. Then that makes sense, though, that it wasn't worth it without the Humble Bundle.
You guys, I keep saying, but I'm basically making you do my talk, actually. You might not know. Would you say the same thing for Linux, or would you go, no, Linux is totally worth it?
I think Linux community is great, and we have found many of the people, like super users in our community, have come from the Linux community. The benefit is not necessarily just tied to the number of sales. There's a lot of tech problems that I'm sure Tim can talk about, but also Linux people will help you with tech problems. It's not like the Mac community where nobody actually knows anything about computers for the most part, so if you have a problem there, you can't actually solve it. But yeah, Linux
Okay, I completely take back what I just said. Linux is worth it. Because you're absolutely right. It's another one of those strong communities, and advocates are worth their weight in gold. Like if they
is there much of a difference with the building between PC and Linux, though? It couldn't be much. Windows. Well, I mean, by comparison to what you're going on about with the consoles.
Well, for starters, I had to spend a whole day trying to install graphics drivers on Linux. I've never used Linux before, and now that I have, I think it's very funny when people will honestly believe it's going to take over from Windows, because it can be used as an operating system with appropriate training.
So can Windows with appropriate
training. Windows.
There was also an entire sub-point of Unity where you literally couldn't build a working Linux version and nobody noticed. For a while.
Or Mac.
Yes, yeah. But that got fixed quicker than the Linux one, which continued on.
Not that quickly. There was a whole point release of Unity where you could not make a Mac build. That was one of the things that make us very upset. No one at Unity had bothered to test their release by attempting to make a Mac build of an empty goddamn scene. It couldn't do that. It couldn't do that for about a month. Which meant for a month, it did not do the basic requirement of the engine. That upset us.
What were your sales for Mac compared to Windows?
About a 10%.
Well,
yeah. Every 100 copies, we sell 10 Mac and 1 Linux. That's almost been completely steady throughout all the ups and downs. You know, 10% of that is Mac, 1% of that is Linux.
Do you sell on any Mac-specific stores or just Steam?
That's just Steam.
That's a massive Mac contingent.
Really?
I think.
Maybe we just don't sell so many PCs. Maybe. I don't know. Maybe Mac users are just like games about teenage pizza delivering ninjas. I don't know, we've just learned something about the Mac demographics. You've got to utilize that. Someone's going to come along with a massive, high-budget pizza delivery game and just clean up Mac users.
By the way, technically, sales data, even on Steam, is NDA.
Really?
Yeah, but it's okay.
I thought you were allowed to show it if you don't show the graph.
Just say this with the Steam spot.
Yeah, Steam.
Seriously. You're only going to jail for, like,
yeah, they can sue us for everything they have. It's not worth the plane ticket to come over here and arrest us. Oh no, we're behind. I think we're pretty safe. I should have, next time I will do the ratios in the form of pantomime. I will have costumes and I will have a routine and we'll have to interpret it. I will dance them. Any other questions? Or are you left stunned from the dance comment? Yes.
So I'm guessing that this is going to be different for every game, but at least for Ninja Pizza Girl, about how much development time would you say you would section off for each of the platforms?
Each of the platforms. Yes, that's a very good question. Full time on it with one person doing the tech stuff, one person doing the forms, I reckon you could get it out in 2 months. But, before Tim explodes. It depends on how technically demanding it is. That's on a title which was fairly not technically demanding. It was deliberately made fairly slow. So even though there were optimizations that were required, they weren't heavy. I didn't have to completely change how I was doing things, for example, or develop new systems. I just really had to trim and, you know, be a bit clever about certain things. So it went in pretty easy. That was actually in design. If you've designed a game so it's going to slot in pretty easily within that, then yeah, probably do it. I don't know, what would you say to you? What would anyone say? Anyone who's done multi? I keep picking on Tim. Who else has done multi-platform development? Okay, what would you say?
I didn't hear the first thing.
How long, if you had one person doing all the tech porting and one person doing everything else, all the forms and communication, how long per platform do you think the port?
You did all the forms, I did all the tech.
It took 2 months.
About 2 months?
Yeah,
2 months, yay! I knew what I was talking about.
That's if you pass the first time around. If you fail, which most devs would the first time, expect to add between 2 to 4 weeks extra.
because it takes about 1 week for them to get back to you. This is
and 1 week to go through.
And 1 week to get it through. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's NDA. We're all going to jail.
2 months.
I didn't say who from.
2 months per
yeah,
platform. That does sound like quite a bit. Like, what,
but
what,
you can run them in parallel. Like, if you've got a big enough team, that's 2 months, and you've got
oh,
three
yeah.
platforms in.
Yeah.
It's funny how money equals speed.
Like, yeah.
That's why we're very slow.
If you're a good coder, and think about it before you start, you can actually sort of inherit a lot of dual functionality. Like,
oh, okay.
If you're smart about it, you can do the same. There's a lot of crossover in the APIs. In terms of functionality, not necessarily in
yeah,
terms of...
Yeah, but you're not going to be able to design it like that until you've seen all the APIs. I suppose if you sit down, look at all the APIs... Yeah. Yeah.
So the title well, I was working
yeah.
on was pretty much done, and I came in and injected the console-ness after the fact.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
You can abstract
yeah.
a lot out.
That's true, that's
you know.
True. If it's
yeah,
yeah. interface is fine.
The
not
way...
the mess that I made, yes.
The way...
Oh, it really helps you become a better coder. Multi-platform development will make you a good coder because all of a sudden you go, oh, that's why the abstraction and the interface, that's why then, yeah, okay, I get it. Because, yeah, you really want to have functionality that you can just clip out and clip in, but the interface to that functionality is the same. That's
you shouldn't. We got away with never having a console-specific pre-processed directive in any game logic.
Nice.
If that's... an indication.
Yeah. Most people.
Yeah.
Most
the coders in
there.
Cruddy, cruddy, cruddy. Anything else? Yeah.
Do you still like pizza?
Do I still like pizza? Okay.
And
during the course of making the game, I discovered that I had a pretty bad allergy to dairy and soy.
Oh no.
Yeah. It was awesome. I thought I was dying for a bit. Because it just got steadily worse, and yeah, discovering that was good, because I'm not dying, I just can't eat things, including pizza. I can make my own pizza and not put cheese on it, which is...
Sad.
Actually, it's not too bad, because a really good pizza, most of the joy in the pizza isn't actually in the cheese, it's in the dough. Like, the stuff you buy is not true pizza. Like, if you just get that and garlic and oil, it's... beautiful, very, very yummy, and it's fun to make. We made it in the last 48 hours of our Kickstarter. And we got it all in the kitchen for some reason, flour all in the kitchen. I don't know, the kids were part of it. I was very sleep deprived, but yeah, it's not too bad. Pizza's good, even if I do have to eat it without cheese. I can't eat any store pizzas though, because it's loaded with dairy and soy. In fact, once you look at the ingredients of a store-bought pizza, you will probably never eat store-bought pizza again. So I looked at all you guys eating the pizza and said, I can't eat that one, that's fine. Any other questions?
Yeah. Did you sell more in Italy?
Did I sell more in Italy? No, we do not have a strong Italian following. We have a surprising following in Brazil. And a surprising following in Japan. Japan's really awesome because obviously the game's... everything about the game is very Japanese influenced. The storytelling is very Japanese. Finish this question? And it's really flattering because when I was growing up, Japan was where all the good games came from. Not necessarily anymore, but...
Well, from software.
So it's really nice there, and it's really surprising because the game is littered with basically offensive Japanese. It's not offensive, but it's like badly translated Japanese because it doesn't take place in Japan. It takes place in some Western country where they have bastardized the concept of a ninja and used it as a marketing ploy. So there's all this Japanese in hiragana that spells things out badly in English. So you will see ninja pizza guru throughout the game, and it's just stupid stuff. If you're Japanese, it just looks like gibberish, but they love it. We actually sent Nicole to Tokyo Game Show, and that wasn't totally just because she could go to Tokyo Game Show. That was for business reasons. That's what she told me while I stayed finding the kids. Most of the kids, the two older kids, she took with her because they also had to go for business reasons. I don't know why. They got to see the world's greatest Street Fighter players, and that's cool because I'm not interested in it. Yeah, go. It's cool. I really liked minding the dog. Anyway, that's where it showed really well, and the Japanese publisher actually approached us. And it was amazing. We were selected as part of something, I can't remember, some competition or something. We were chosen, and we were terribly thrilled. And that's our surprise demographic, not Italy. Not the pizza part, but the ninja part. They've actually liked our terrible, offensive interpretations of their culture. It's really weird.
My question was, I think you've answered it. I wanted to know the exact literal back-to-English translation of the Japanese translation of the title, but it sounds like it's not a Japanese translation. That all.
We did something. It's.
I think that's reasonable payback for all your base that belong to us.
Yeah, it pretty much is.
You translate into an Asian language, they translate back.
It is Jinglish, but it's... I don't know what you'd call the opposite version.
The opposite.
Jinglish.
English.
It's English. It is all your base up along to us. That's what the game is filled with.
Awesome.
Not the actual dialogue that's been lovely translated, and I hope they've captured the jokes because the jokes are really good. Some people like them.
Is the name actually translated into Japanese? Because our advice we got was to actually leave it as an English name.
The logo is still English.
That's the same.
Yeah. The logo's still. In that really culturally appropriated and offensive pseudo-Asian font, because that was the first thing we did, and we printed them on T-shirts and took them to PAX Oz, and then some English people said that was terribly offensive, and we've worried about that ever since, but the Japanese seem to think it's great, so...
We printed our logo on T-shirts and changed it anyway.
Yeah, but we couldn't afford another run. It's like, it's done, move on.
Yeah, no, we just got a bunch of old logos stuck around the place, it's great.
We sort of approached development the opposite of you know how you're always going, okay, I've done it, I could do it better. We go, we've done that. It's done, we can never change it, move on. Do something different. Looking at it makes us sick. It's good because after 4 years, Nicole has only just gotten to the point where looking at the game makes her want to throw up, which is pretty good because in our first title, that was after 9 months and she couldn't handle it anymore. But it's only just happened. I can actually still quite enjoy playing the game, but after 4 years, she has finally hit the saturation point where hearing the music or anything, she's, no, switch it off. I don't want to hear it anymore. Marketing Ninja Pizza Girl Masterclass.
You'll only get sick of it after 4 years.
After 4 years. We have people... I should talk about our user base a little bit. It's kind of part of the Was It Worth It. We have people who have well over 100 hours on the game in Steam. You play through the story in 3 hours. You can 100% it in 6 hours. The... console launch was met with a guy, he just tweeted me. He's like the online version of a Booth Barnacle, but he's great. He's an insomniac. He stayed up for 30 hours straight playing Ninja Pizza Girl, wanting to be the first person in the world to 100% it. He got a key code before it was released, so you know he could be number one. And he wasn't. He was third.
How quick were the first two?
I don't know.
I was going to say, was it you and Nicole?
Yes.
No, I'm not staying up 30 hours straight at 100% of the game. And then he moved on to being number one in speedrun all. Now, we've actually included a speedrun mode. It was one of the things that we thought would add a little longevity to it. Some people really get into that mode. I imagine it's the same as your boss rush modes and the various things you've got.
We had a speedrun tournament
nice.
For the month.
Yeah. Yeah, my dream is actually to get on Games Done Quick. Games Done Quick is really cool.
Another question for you, but actually something about multi-platform stuff that was covering If you're doing leaderboards of any kind, you should structure the setup assuming that you don't get data back immediately,
yes,
or even close to immediately. Do a lot of local caching because may or may not find problems with that.
API warning, scoping PDAs. Yeah. Well, that's sort of what we were talking about before with the async programming.
But that's not like, that's not necessarily something you'll run into until you actually get to the other platform.
That's good network practice. Cache what data you can, and get used to async.
This is also
design
a crucial thing, is like different platforms use different metaphors, and which, if you run into that, it is
hard finding a common language a common structure for all the APIs.
Yeah, because you can work around different coding, different API stuff, but when you run into a different metaphor that affects your code architecture, which can potentially be a much bigger task you run into it blind.
Just abstraction layers. Layers.
But that's, you need to understand the metaphors you're potentially going to deal with to make an abstraction that can handle
it. What we really should do, if you're going to develop for three platforms, is before you start implementing the first platform, you should probably read the API instructions for the others so you don't implement something that translates very badly. Because basically what I've done is all my network APIs, like the leaderboards and the cloud saving, is basically written in Steam-ish. And then all the other platforms have to be translated to Steam-ish in how they deal with stuff. And that's often a very poor translation. And it would be much better to read through all the APIs and devise some sort of common language that they would all speak better. But it's still hard. And you look like you're just going to stare into space and say, it was hard. Whiskey. It's alright. It's fun. It's fun. It's a laugh.
James.
Makes you a much better coder.
I'm not sure if this is a very dumb question, but would it be feasible to release on one
platform?
Nothing
we do is smart. We're game developers.
Yeah, exactly. Release on one platform, and then gauge based on the success and reaction of that, maybe take some of the money and get a different team to develop for other platforms.
Oh yeah, I mean there's absolutely so many ways you can do it depending on the amounts of money involved. Absolutely. Really, it's tough. For us, one of the reasons why I'd go back in time and do iOS only is because you could look at the performance of that. And if it was lackluster, you could go, this does not justify any more platforms, let's do something else. Instead of building up... We have already sold Wii U copies of the game, and we sold Wii U copies of those games 2 years ago. And they've been very patient. But that's
Because
of the Kickstarter.
Oh,
that is stupid. Yeah. From the business point of view, there's... utterly stupid making that sort of commitment, which is why I think you get a lot of Kickstarters popping, because you have to get excited and you have to promise things and you have to kind of hope it all works out. And it's one of the reasons why I recommend against Kickstarters, because all of a sudden you're beholden to these people and you may or may not have the resources to deliver on it. Now, we've scrounged up the resources, but we have paid for that with time. So, yes, we would go back in time, we would do our cheapest, easiest platform, and we would use that to measure we'd go from there, because in game development you want to fail as quickly as possible. However, someone like Defiant, where they know they've got the cash, they know they've got the backing, they've got the confidence, they can allocate the budget and come out, do a simultaneous launch, like a nice big boom at once, and there's of course all areas in between that. So it really depends on your size, scope, the positions you're in, the sources of your funding, the deals you have to make. Almost anything's viable. Almost anything can be stupid.
The PR agency that we use highly recommended that you try and launch on everything at once.
Yes.
for various business reasons. If that's possible, that is their always preferred method.
That's right. A simultaneous release is great. I would say that if you've got two people or three people, don't do that.
Yeah.
You're not going to have the resources to manage that launch.
We did not.
No, you didn't do that. That's actually been the subject of much discussion Nicole's been having with her super secret friends on super secret mailing lists. There's been a lot of back and forth on this. And there's pros and cons to both approaches, but basically if you're small, don't do it because you can't. Unless you fail. If you don't sell any, you can probably do it because you won't have to manage any PR on release. Your release date will be nice and quiet. But planning for failure is probably not the best approach. So yeah, I wouldn't do it. We're doing the two release now, and it's been crazy. Depends. All depends. Depends. What else? That's a blast to end on, isn't it? Depends. Very deep. Yeah, well, that's why I wanted to get everyone involved. It would have been great to have more men on the Dan, just to get a perspective from a larger company. It would have been great to have the Armello guys.
I've been quiet.
Yeah,
I'm from Defiant.
I know. Yeah. I don't know how much you wanted to say that. So.
Yeah.
You've been sitting there nodding, going, they are much smaller than us. Mm-hmm. It's tiny, tiny. It should be easy to crush them. And talk to them.
It's your platform.
I mean, obviously, you do things very differently. Because you have the resources to do
so. That's very true, yeah.
And it's good, and we'd love to be in that position one day. So this talk has really been about teeny-weeny people doing improbable things, which has only been possible with the generosity of a lot of people, a lot of support, and as much as I like to complain about it, with Unity, it wouldn't have been possible doing it any other way.
So that's awesome.
Never. I shall always win.
Guy,
is that?
Yeah.
Everyone done?
Cool.
Instructions, I will say very quickly, 90% of doing the port is looking for the instructions. They won't be easy to find. Design. Design it from the ground up to be portable, and your life will be much easier. Brains, your brains will get squished out your ears unless you have money to hire more people. Tiny, whiny, slippery, slidey, the slower you go, the harder it gets, the slower you go. Once again, get money and resources so you don't have to go so slow. Be rich.
And that's it. That's a very quick summary of the remaining things.
Thank you very much for listening to me.
It was hard.